Good morning, Bethany Church.
Good morning.
As you could tell by the efforts that this is Palm Sunday, and we're glad that you're here to share it with us.
We thank Addie for leading us.
We thank Addie for leading. She's too busy talking now. In your bulletin, you will find a little tab on the side. If you've had a change of address or want somebody to contact you, any information, and please fill that out and drop it in the collection plate when it comes around. And let's see the bulletin for any announcements. Of course, next Sunday's being Easter, and we're to have breakfast, right?
Yes. 9:30 a.m.
9:30 a.m. Do what? Okay.
I'm not sure.
Well, would somebody mind bringing two? I'm not that good a cook. Worship service would be the same as 10:15 for Easter.
The Easter egg hunt.
And the Easter egg hunt will be at 10 a.m. After the breakfast. And I hope Addie has some friends to join her in that. Herb and I are a little too old to hunt Easter eggs. I might get over, but I might not straighten back up either.
You have to hide them if you're too old.
Yeah, or if you put them up about this high.
Yeah.
Well, would you join me in the responsive reading this morning? Okay. Board meeting.
5 o'clock board meeting.
Way up the top, yeah. You know, you'd think I could read better than that, wouldn't you?
You'd think.
But I'm reading two lines at a time. It doesn't take that long. Yeah, okay, yeah, board meeting.
Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy riven side which flow,
oh, be your sin the double cure. Cleanse me from guilt and power.
Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling.
Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to
responsive reading, please. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
We bless you from the house of the Lord.
Let us worship God. We praise you, O God, for your faithfulness through the ages. You are with us as we greet the dawn of the new day. Your word guides us as we seek your obedience. You comfort us during the distress and judge us according to your righteousness. As you see it, Jesus, to fulfill your promise, to fill us with your Spirit, that we may know your will. As we enter the gates of your sacred space, Hear now our voices as we sing our praises to you. Amen. Will the children come forward for children's hour?
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong, they are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes.
be another good Hosanna song than Marching to Zion. Welcome, everybody. Glad that you are here. Glad that everybody is here and glad that you have had a week full of ministry. And in that week full of ministry, there's several reports I need to make to you. Gail Kinney had her surgeries on her eyes completed, and she's making good recovery. So thank God for that. Dave Baum, he is doing pretty good. And I got to have coffee with him again this week. Rita Pruitt is at home and making her recovery, but she still has treatments yet to go. And so please continue to remember her in prayer as her family and she take this journey through dealing with her cancer. Mandy Rhodes will have surgery in another week or so please remember her. Her family coming in, that's my daughter's mother-in-law. And that surgery is on her cancer. I wanted to say an appreciation, Don, thank you for going with me yesterday. Baron Moore came on to hospice this last week, and Don went with me for a visit yesterday. It was our last visit before Don died last night. And so you want to remember he and his family in prayer. I know that Connie went over to her sister's house to spend the night. She called me just after they had finally picked up his body. But I was grateful for us to be able to spend the time in prayer that we did. He had a large family get to come and visit with him last week, and they went out and put up a canopy and had a little picnic time out in the yard, and family got to spend some time together, and it was a profitable time, not just in fellowship with the family, but also in doing those things that need to be done. I know that he and some of his family had not seen each other in a long time, and there was some reconciliation that took place there, and I'm grateful for that. And I know that Connie is also. Connie wanted me to say personally to you how much she appreciates your prayers and those of you who spent some time, especially giving her calls or making personal contacts with her. The Ukrainian people, we need to continue, of course, to remember the Ukraine and all of its people and to continue to deal with that very difficult and horrible situation, asking God's comfort and his goodness and his joy in the midst of difficulty. Praying that it doesn't go any further. It doesn't go any further. I keep having memories or visions of as Russia gets closer to the city of Odessa, that there is a beautiful concert hall there that I went to. When I visited Russia, I went to a ballet there, and it was gorgeous, beautiful, beautiful place. And they loved me talking about the Globe Theater here, because Odessa is a sister city of Odessa. And they said they compared the two together. The city of Odessa is called the Hero City. You may already know that, but I wanted to give you something in your mind to remember and pray for. Hero City, because it was the city where the revolution started, back when the Bolshevik revolution started. And I'd like to see a revolution against Russia start again there, perhaps, from the soldiers themselves who are Russian soldiers. But at that time also, they had gone through difficult times. The Nazis had occupied Odessa then, and they had actually had planted bombs around that beautiful theater and were going to blow it up before they left. And they were able to, liberators were able to get to the bombs before they were ignited, and they disconnected them and saved that beautiful, beautiful theater. One of these days I'll show you some slides, maybe pretty soon, of that beautiful theater in Odessa. Who else do we want to remember in prayer? I know there are others. You have some unspoken prayer requests. Jody is much better. I wanted to share that with you. You know, she's been dealing with the bronchitis all of her life. We usually got it twice a year. We'd have bronchitis, and she coughed horribly, and this year it was just worse than it's ever been. But she has since had some tests run, and she's got some inhalers, and they decided that she had had asthma all of her life, and just as a child and never treated it. So she's getting it treated now. So she's not coughing now. It's good to see. Yes, my, it is a terrible thing when she's coughing. She coughs all night long. So thank God for that. Who else do you want to remember? Are there praises that you may want to share?
Here this morning.
Who?
Sue.
Sue's here this morning. I'm grateful for that. Claire had a fall this last week, or stuff fell on him. Yeah, I can see it in his face. Yeah, healing of his body. And Claire, if you want to come up, we'll anoint you later if you want to, if you don't go fishing next week. Like you did the last time we anointed you. We healed him and he went fishing the next week. which we were grateful for. Anybody else? Paula. Remember Lori in prayer. All right. Thank you. Thank you for reminding us. Who else? All right. Let me lead us in prayer and we'll conclude with the Lord's Prayer. Lord, we love you so very much and we thank you for touching the lives of those that we've talked about. And there are more in our mind's eye, Lord Jesus, people who've been healed and encouraged. And we ask that you continue to heal, Lord, and encourage. Those prayer requests are corporate today, Lord. They'll continue as private prayer requests throughout the week. We ask earnestly your blessing and your help and your goodness and opportunity for us to be able to serve you through ministry. Now, Father, even as you've taught us to pray, we pray. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's sing again together.
Of wonder, how rolled the sea.
technique. Stand together for the doxology. Thank you, elders. Reading from the book of Revelation, chapter 2, beginning in verse 8, to the angel of the church of Smyrna write, "These are the words of him who is the first and the last, who died and came to life again. I know your afflictions and your poverty, yet you are rich. I know the slander of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. Be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes will not be hurt at all by the second death." And then from chapter 6, verses 3 and 4, "When the Lamb opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature say, 'Come.' And then another horse came out, a fiery red one. Its rider was given power to take peace from the earth and to make men slay one another. To him was given a large sword." And then from the 8th chapter, beginning with verse 8, "The second angel sounded his trumpet, and something like a huge mountain, all ablaze, was thrown into the sea. A third of the sea turned into blood. A third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships were destroyed." And then last, from chapter 16, verse 3, "The second angel poured out his bowl on the sea, and it turned into blood like that of a dead man, and every living thing in the sea died." I do want to remind you about other activities that are going to be coming up this week, this being Holy Week, and I hope that you will make every day of it a celebration in remembering the last day of our, last week of our Lord's life. On Thursday, we will have a brief Maundy Thursday service here at 7 o'clock. 7 o'clock in the evening on Thursday, a very brief one. We'll just be singing a few songs a cappella and then taking the Lord's Supper in a very brief message. It won't be a long service at all. And then, of course, on Easter Sunday, you want to remember the service on Easter Sunday, coming together and enjoying our breakfast and our Easter egg hunt and our worship. From the oil industry has come some wonderful things. There has come oil and gasoline, and all of the hydrocarbons that we make things out of, fuels and plastics, polymers, and hundreds of other byproducts, such that the industry is worth billions and billions of dollars. As Don and I, as we were headed out to Connie's the other day, on Saturday, we were driving on the way out there, a good distance out to Connie's, and Don made a comment how that if it weren't for the oil industry, there wouldn't be anything between here and there, and that's true. It would just be desolate desert area out there. But oil industry has brought a new way of life to us, and billions of billions of dollars. Wars have even been started over oil and its byproducts. Competence in the oil field industry will find that eternal value of oil balancing itself with the cultural excesses that it can create. Oil has brought great profit to us. Oil has brought jobs to us. Oil has brought great advancement in science and the development of plastics in particular to us. And yet at the same time, it has also brought a cultural excess to us, excesses that have come as a result of it. The church at Smyrna allowed what is cultural to overshadow the eternal that was going on in its midst. Each of these churches has been assigned the gospel, and Smyrna is among them, assigned the gospel of the Lord Jesus to be a good steward of it. But each of these churches in the book of Revelation have also chastised for excesses that they have allowed to enter into their congregation to overshadow the eternal. In the church at Smyrna, it actually came in the form of discrimination. They were discriminating against the Jews. And indifferent toward the poor. The poor and the Jews were discriminated against. And among the poor, especially the women in the church were being discriminated against. Actually, it was the same excesses that were seen in the church in Germany just before World War II. The same excesses. The real reality of the red horse of violence found in the book of Revelation is racial prejudice and sexual prejudice, sexual persecution. They're illustrated in the church at Smyrna. You say, how is that, Jimmy? It's happened since the Christ event. Were it not for the Christ event, we wouldn't have seen those kinds of things as being excesses and as being evils. On the sea of mankind, death has become of blood. Race has been turned against itself. In this world, there is persecution, and that persecution is as a result of the gospel. That persecution has come in the form of racial persecution, because you and I are seen in Christ no longer to recognize race. And so as a result, there is war. There are those who have excesses. And there are those who still see racial prejudice as a reality. Sitting on the front steps of my grandfather's house in Hobbs, New Mexico, where I was born, I would go back and help him paint his house in the summers. And we'd sit out on the front porch, and I would ask him questions about a variety of things. I still remember all the answers to those questions, though they were wrong, most of them. It was still fun to be able to talk to him. Talked about the moon, looked up the moon. I said, Grandpa, we just landed a man on the moon. He said, no, that was a lie. That didn't really happen. That was all done on stage somewhere. There was not a man that's landed on the moon. Okay, Grandpa. I understand that your daddy told me that you have decided to become a minister. And I said, yeah, Grandpa, that's true. I said, I have decided that God is calling me to be a minister. Well, don't you ever minister to blacks? And I said, do what? And he said, don't you ever minister to blacks because they're not human. And I said, Grandpa, you can't possibly believe that. I said, you're an old half-breed Apache. What are you doing being prejudiced against other people? And he said, that's different. Blacks aren't human. They're just well-trained animals. Don't let me ever hear you ministering to them. Part of the prejudice. Had it not been for what Christ did in us, we would have had that kind of mentality about those things forever. Pastoring a church in Amarillo, Eastridge Baptist Church, I gained my great notoriety as a minister. You know, everybody gets to be in the sunlight 15 minutes, they say. Get your 15 minutes of light, you know, where the world looks at you. I got mine while I was there. Because we were a Southern Baptist church and we decided to ordain a woman. God forbid. All war broke loose. Not only was there a big meeting, was attended by 400 or 500 people, in which they threatened to disfellowship our church if we would ordain that woman. I had several members that were opposed to that vote say, Jimmy, we're going to leave the church. I said, why would you do that? I mean, the people voted unanimously, well, not unanimously, but overwhelmingly to ordain her as a minister. In fact, the hospital here in Amarillo has asked us to ordain her because she's not getting into the benefits, tax benefits, as a minister. She's already ministering there, but she's not been ordained. And then lastly, I had a group of friends take me out to lunch and threaten me that not only would they destroy things that I had tried to help establish, such as a Bible chair at Amarillo College, that they would defund it so that that minister would lose his job and they would no longer have Bible classes, but that they would personally harm me if I were to continue on with it. It's a difficult day. I was very young, a young minister, and also as egotistical as I could be, thinking I could handle anything, don't need to share anything with anybody. My vehicles were vandalized. My home was vandalized. Eventually, the church said, we're not going to ordain her because we've been threatened. She was finally ordained, and I got to preach her ordaining message at a church in Dallas, a church that had already ordained several women to ministry, but the panhandle of Texas was the last holdout, and those old cowboys were not about to say that a woman can take up the offering. Prejudice exists in the church, and to fight it was something that I decided to do, and as a result, got blacklisted even. By several churches. W.A. Criswell, anybody know him? Pastor of First Baptist Church Dallas. He blacklisted me. He put me on a list of ministers that should not pastor Baptist churches anymore because I believe that women could speak and preach the gospel. The world is a difficult place. Persecution is a reality, and many of us are not touched by it, but we find out that because Jesus came and because we stand up for right, there will be persecution. And I'm amazed at how the persecution still exists and how deep it is, even hidden in some people's hearts, even for later. The church at Smyrna was experiencing that. They were a church of the gospel, yet they let their old prejudices rise up inside of them, and it spoke against others. From Matthew, the 15th chapter, beginning with the first verse, then some Pharisees and teachers of the law came to Jesus from Jerusalem and asked, why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? They don't wash their hands before they eat. Jesus replied, and why do you break the command of God for the sake of your traditions? For God said, honor your father and mother, and anyone who curses his mother or father must be put to death. But you say that if a man says to his father or mother, whatever help you might otherwise have received from me is a gift devoted to God, he is not to honor his father with it. Thus you nullify the word of God for the sake of your tradition. You hypocrites, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men. Jesus called the crowd to him and said, listen and understand. What goes into a man's mouth does not make him unclean, but what comes out of his mouth, that is what makes him unclean. Christ has brought to the ahead the crisis of that which is racial persecution and even sexual persecution. In order to bring the world to peace, you and I are called by Christ to be able to stand up for what is right, to enter into worship with those who are of different race, to worship and even be led by those of a different sex, and even economic levels are to be not recognized. This is what he meant when he said in Ephesians 6, you are to girt yourselves with the belt of truth. If you girt yourself with the belt of truth, what is true, regardless of what superstitions or other people's rules say about it. You and I know that. You and I know that race and sex is not a measurement of truth any more than food or traditions. And Paul even addressed those. If Paul had addressed the others, perhaps it wouldn't have become such a problem. Worship can be distorted by racial persecution and by sexual persecution. Reading from the book of Galatians, from chapter 3, verse 26 through 29. You are all sons of God through faith in Jesus Christ. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male or female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. If you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. And then the last verse I want to read is coming from Galatians 5. So I say to you, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. For the sinful nature desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the sinful nature. They are in conflict with each other, so that you do not what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace, and patience, and kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying one another. That same W.A. Criswell that I mentioned to you earlier, pastor of First Baptist Church Dallas, was faced with an ordeal in the 60s. He shared it with those of us in a class one day. How that there was a group, because of the reaction of civil disobedience and civil rights issues during the 60s, there was a group of people who were going around and joining or trying to join Baptist churches, black individuals trying to join Baptist churches. They wouldn't stay in the church. They just wanted to see what would happen if they came down and tried to join the church, serendipitously and surprising them. And it happened at First Baptist Church Dallas. And still recall some of the conflicts that came into that congregation as a result of that, because the man came down and said that he'd like to become a member of the church. And W.A. Criswell faced the congregation and said, then I'll take a vote. And a person said, Baptists do that. You know, they take votes during the service. And so the person voted, said, I vote that he is allowed into our church. And there was a great murmur through the church. And then another person said, I second that vote, that be accepted into the church. And then there were several people shouting, no, 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 from the congregation. Can you imagine what that must have been like? And W.A. Criswell simply said, let's vote. All those in favor say aye. And they said aye. And the nays, which were not as many, still tried to make themselves heard louder. And he said, the ayes have it. Mr. Brown is now a member of our church. And then W.A. Criswell, though, added something else to it, which I appreciate. As the service began to close, he recognized that there was going to be a split off there was going to be a group of people who were going to leave the church as a result of the vote. And he simply asked them, he said, wait just a moment while you're standing before you leave. What did you expect me to do? And he said, I know that those of you that may have voted no won't answer that, because you know that to deny a person access into the body of Christ is ungodly and unchristlike. He said, I don't know what the motivations are. All I know is Mr. Brown has asked to be a member here. He said he's a Christian and we voted him in. We will accept that because that's what Jesus would have us do. Church didn't divide. There were some discussions later on about it. Now, he was notorious for doing things like that, and there were very other things that he did like that also. He once said, and I'll end with this because it's time to go. He took an old Bible with him into the pulpit. And that church being the large church that it is, and this happens in any large church because I've been a part of them and even pastored one, they can also have a lot of divisions and a lot of different opinions. In a Baptist church, you get to voice them. He brought that Bible into the pulpit and he said, is this your Bible? Is this the Bible you believe? And he said, no, you don't. And he looked to a place, a passage that has that male and female, Jew or Greek, are one in Christ. He said, you don't believe that. And he ripped it out of the Bible and threw it in the floor. And he said, what about this loving one another? Do y'all believe that? No, you don't. And he ripped it out of the Bible and threw it in the floor. And he continued for, he was a showman. He continued for a while until it was just a flappy mess. And he goes, that's the Bible y'all believe. You need to repent and be Christ-like. Ooh, I'm not going to do that today. Thank God, huh? Bow your heads if you would. Lord Jesus, we love you so very much. You are our master and we follow you. And Father, even though your coming has brought great crisis because the world standards war against the spiritual standards, Lord, and we have trouble with them, we will not revoke the world's, we will not revoke the Spirit's standards, but rather we will fight against the world's standards, keeping abreast and keeping before us that which is the loving gospel of you, Lord Jesus. We love you, and we ask in these few moments that we think about that which is in our own hearts, Father, that you help us to repent where repentance is needed, and that also, Lord Jesus, we will commit to at least consider what we disagree with. In Jesus' name, right where you are with the music playing, I invite you to respond to Christ's call, to respond to the call in your own heart and right where you are. But if you have a decision to make to receive Christ as Savior, become a member of the church, to dedicate yourself to service, whatever God has called you to do, I'll meet you here at the front and we'll pray for you. We won't go long. Spend your time through.
Someone slipped on. Was that someone you? You may have wronged or added strength, your courage to renew. Do not be disheartened, for I have news for you. It is no secret. Pardon me.